Good morning, everyone. So today's lecture is on the physiology of respiration. So we all know that, all human beings, they require oxygen for survival. So we breathe in oxygen and we breathe out carbon dioxide. And the carbon dioxide that we breathe out is taken up by the plants for the process of photosynthesis. And such processes, they help in the symbiotic relationship. So in today's lecture, we are going to talk about these important objectives. So we are going to cover these objectives. Difference between breathing and respiration. Secondly, we are going to discuss about the structure of lungs, breathing mechanism, inspiration and expiration. So before we get into the structure of lungs and we get into the mechanism of inspiration and expiration, it is important to understand the basic difference between breathing and respiration. So first we will have a look at what is breathing. So what is breathing? The process in which air moves in and out of the lungs is called breathing. Okay. This is carried out through various respiratory organs. In other words, breathing is as simple give and take process. So what happens in breathing is that air is given out, it is taken into the lungs and carbon dioxide is given out. And this process of air moving in and moving out in the lungs is called breathing. And breathing is carried out using different types of respiratory organs. So breathing is a simple give and take process. The process of taking in oxygen rich air is known as inhalation. On the contrary, the process of giving out air that is rich in carbon dioxide is called exhalation. Breathing is a physical process of inhalation of oxygen and exhalation of carbon dioxide from the lungs to promote gaseous exchange within the environment. So this is a physical process. So breathing is a much more on the surface. It's an external process. It is a physical process. And what does it involve? It basically involves the process of inhalation of oxygen and exhalation of carbon dioxide from the lungs, and it promotes this gaseous exchange with the environment. Whereas on the other hand, what is respiration? Respiration is the biochemical process of releasing energy which can be utilized by our body cells to perform various daily activities like walking, sitting, running and other life processes. Respiration is essential and it is inevitable for maintaining the proper functioning of the organ system. So there is a basic difference between breathing and respiration. We see that on one hand, breathing is a physical process, okay, of just breathing in oxygen and breathing out carbon dioxide, as a result of which it helps in the exchange of gases between the human body and the environment. But what is respiration on the other hand? Respiration on the other hand is a biochemical process in which energy is released at the end of it, and this energy which is released by respiration is used up by different organs of the body to perform different functions and to carry out their day-to-day activities. Now, in order to understand respiration, the organ which is involved for the process of respiration is the lungs. So it is very important to understand the structure of the lungs. Now, lungs are what? It is a pair. So there are pair. That means there are two parts. This is the right side and this is the left side. So the lungs are a pair of spongy air-filled organ located on either side of the chest or the thorax. So we say that the chest is the thorax. And on both the side of the thorax, you have two air-filled organ or a spongy organ, which is called lungs. Now, there is a windpipe which conducts the inhaled air into the lungs through the tubular branches, which is called the bronchi. So, here you have a windpipe or the trachea. And then there is a smaller part, the trachea breaks down into this right bronchi and the left bronchus. Okay. So, the subdivision of the trachea, they are called bronchus. The main windpipe is called trachea. It breaks down into right bronchus and left bronchus. And the bronchus further breaks down into further branches, which are called bronchioles. And at the end of the bronchioles, you have this circular sac-like structure, which are called alveoli. So what is the lung? Lung is made up of two, bag-like, sac-like air-filled structure on the two sides of the chest. There is a main windpipe or trachea, which conducts the inhaled air from the trachea to the further branches, that is the bronchi. The bronchi then divide into smaller and smaller branches, which are called bronchioles. The bronchioles eventually end in cluster of microscopic air sacs, which are called alveoli. Now, it is the alveoli where the exchange of oxygen with carbon dioxide takes place. Okay, it is that place where oxygen is absorbed and carbon dioxide is given out. Now, carbon dioxide, a waste product of metabolism, it travels from the blood to the alveoli where it can be exhaled. Between the alveoli is a thin layer of cells called the interstitium, which contains blood vessels and cells and that help support the alveoli. The lungs are covered by a thin tissue layer which is called the pleura. So, lungs, they have a pleural membrane, and sometimes you must have heard that there is water in the lungs. So, it is this pleural membrane or the cavity which gets filled up with water and is not good. So, what happens is the blood, it is carrying, you know, that from the heart the blood goes to the lungs and the lungs oxygenate it and pass it back through the veins to the heart. So it is this processing or purification of the blood that takes place in the heart. So alveoli are the small air sacs which is responsible for absorbing the carbon dioxide and giving out the fresh oxygen back to the blood. And this fresh oxygen carrying blood is carried to the different parts of the body. Now, as I said, the lungs, they are covered by a thin tissue-like structure, which is called pleura. Now, the same kind of thin tissue lines the inside of the chest cavity. A thin layer of fluid acts as a lubricant, allowing the lungs to slip smoothly as they expand and contract in each breath. Obviously, in each breath, they will expand and contract. So, between the walls and the lungs, there is a little bit of fluid present, which is known as the pleural fluid, and it helps in the proper functioning of the lungs. Now, once we have understood the difference between breathing and respiration, we should also understand what are the different modes of breathing. Now, respiratory movements, they are classified by the pattern of muscle activity into quiet breathing, it is known as the eupnea, forced breathing, hypernea, and apnea, it is known as the sleep apnea. So, what is quiet breathing? It involves active inhalation and passive exhalation. Diaphragmatic breathing or deep breathing, it is also called costal breathing or shallow breathing. So it is a very silent breathing. When you breathe, there is not much noise. Okay, it is called quiet breathing and it is known as eupnea. So this happens when you inhale highly but you exhale very slowly. Now the next is the forced breathing or hypernea. It involves active inhalation and exhalation. So when you breathe in and breathe out with a lot of force, with a lot of effort, then it is known as hypernea. It is assisted by accessory muscles. Maximum level, it occurs in exhaustion. And what is apnea? No movement of muscles of respiration and volume of the lung remains unchanged. So what happens is the lung's volume does not change. So whatever is happening is only in the nasal cavity, and sometimes you can hear loud noises. Okay, because whatever you are taking in is not reaching the lungs. There is no movement of the lungs. So whatever activity takes place, it takes place in the nasal cavity and creates sleep apnea. So the eupnea, hypernea, and apnea are the three different modes of breathing. We know that breathing is a physical process which involves the inhalation of oxygen and exhalation of carbon dioxide and maintains a balance or the exchange of gases between human beings and the environment. Now, what is this mechanism of breathing? Now, the air which we breathe in and out of the lungs varies in pressure. Obviously, you know, the air that we breathe in and we breathe out, the pressure involved in the two are not the same. They are of varying pressure. Now, breathing mechanism, they are of two types. One we say is inspiration or inhalation, and the other is called expiration or exhalation. Now, when there is a fall in air pressure, the alveolar spaces falls and the air enters the lung. And as the pressure of the alveoli within exceeds the atmospheric pressure, the air is blown from the lungs. The flow rate of air is in proportion to the magnitude of the pressure difference. So what happens is when there is a pressure difference or when the pressure inside the alveoli is low, it needs certain amount of oxygen in order to build up the pressure. So inhalation occurs, oxygen comes in, and it ultimately fills up the alveoli. But due to the inhalation of oxygen, if there is no exhalation process and there is constant inhalation, the alveoli, it reaches its threshold and it might burst. And that is the point when they exhale or gives out the carbon dioxide. So carbon dioxide has been substituted with oxygen. So oxygen fills up the spaces of this air sacs and carbon dioxide is given out. So this inhaling of the oxygen for increasing the pressure of the alveoli or alveolus, it is known as inspiration or inhalation, and giving out of the carbon dioxide in order to release the excess pressure by alveoli, it is called expiration. So in the inspiration and expiration process, the pressure difference is significant. So whenever we talk about breathing mechanism, the two things that we should talk about is inspiration and expiration. So you see, in when you inhale, what happens is the diaphragm or the exhalation, it's the muscles relax, but in inhalation it contracts. Okay, so I think first we will talk about inspiration. We will see what happens during inspiration or inhalation, and then we will talk about the mechanism of inspiration. Now, what happens in inspiration? In the process of inspiration, there would be a contraction of muscles attached to the ribs on the outer side, which pulls out the ribs and results in the expansion of the chest cavity. So what is happening is, when you are breathing in something or when you are inhaling something, the muscles of the heart or the chest, they are contracting. The ribs on the outer side, it pulls out the ribs and results in the expansion of the chest cavity. Later, the diaphragm contracts, move downwards and expands the chest cavity, resulting in the contraction of the abdominal muscles. The expansion of the chest cavity produces a partial vacuum, which sucks air into the lungs and fills the expanded alveoli. So what happens is that during the process of inspiration, what is happening is the chest cavity is expanding in size. Okay, the diaphragm is going down, you know, and the chest cavity is expanding, or it is increasing in volume. Now, obviously, if the chest cavity is increasing in volume, they will have to accommodate more and more air in order to fill up the empty space of the void. So more oxygen is taken in to fill up the expanded alveoli, because when the chest cavity increases, the size of the alveoli or the alveolus also increases. And if the size of the alveoli or the alveolus also increases, then they will have to take in a significant amount of oxygen in. Okay, so that is what they are saying, that in the process of inspiration, what happens, the muscles, they contract, and the lungs or the chest cavity, it increases. Later, the diaphragm contracts, moves downwards, and because of the increase in chest cavity, it produces a partial vacuum, because there is a certain amount of void, and that is when oxygen is taken in. Okay, so see, this is a cavity. So during inspiration or inhalation, the chest cavity or the thoracic cavity, it expands. Because a vacuum is created, obviously more oxygen or more air is sucked in, and it fills up the empty spaces in the alveoli, and the diaphragm, it contracts. Okay, so thoracic cavity expands, it increases in volume, and more amount of oxygen or gases comes inside the nasal cavity to the lungs. Now we will talk about the mechanism of inspiration. So what is this mechanism of inspiration? The process of intake of atmospheric air is known as inspiration, and it is an active process. When the volume of the thoracic cavity increases, they creates it a void, you know, or maybe a kind of a vacuum is created. So the air pressure, it decreases, as a result of which, in order to balance that pressure inside, more air from outside, it goes into the thoracic cavity to fill up the expanded spaces of the alveoli. Contraction of the external intercostal muscles increase the volume of the thoracic cavity. Contraction of the diaphragm also contracts, as a result of which the volume of the thoracic cavity further increases, because everything is working in order to expand or increase the volume of the thoracic cavity during inspiration. When you take a deep breath, that is what happens, that the diaphragm contracts and the volume of the thoracic cavity, it expands or increases. Now, suddenly, if the thoracic cavity increases, it is but obvious that a void or a vacuum will be created. where the pressure becomes low. Now, in order to satisfy or to bring the pressure to normal, more amount of air or oxygen is sucked in, and that is what happens in inhalation. So, contraction of the diaphragm further increases the size of the thoracic cavity. Simultaneously, the lungs expand. With the expansion of the lungs, the air pressure inside it decreases. In order to equalize the pressure, a significant amount of oxygen or air is sucked into the nasal cavity to the thoracic cavity, where it fills up the spaces, the empty spaces of the expanded alveoli. So that is what happens during inspiration or inhalation. Okay. So I hope that we know that the breathing mechanism is very simple. It's a physical process where it is taking in oxygen and giving out carbon dioxide. But inhalation process, when we study about the mechanism, we see that when we inhale or when we take a deep breath, actually the diaphragm, which is at the bottom of the lung, it contracts and the thoracic cavity increases. With increase in the volume of the thoracic cavity, there is a certain void or a vacuum created inside, which causes the air pressure inside to drop, as a result of which more amount of oxygen or air is sucked in order to balance the pressure, and this results in the process of inhalation. Now, next we have is the expiration or exhalation, and we will talk about the mechanism of expiration. So, what is expiration? Now, expiration process is considered once after the gaseous exchange occurs in the lungs and air is expelled out. The expulsion of air is called expiration. During this process, muscles attached to the ribs, they contract. Muscles of the diaphragm and the abdomen, they relax, which leads to a decrease in the volume of the chest cavity. And increases the pressure of the lungs, causing the air in the lungs to be pushed out of the nose. Now, here it is just the opposite. Now, in the case of inhalation, the diaphragm is contracting. Now, here the thoracic cavity suddenly decreases or shrinks in size, and the diaphragm, it relaxes. Now, both the shrinking of the thoracic cavity and relaxation of the diaphragm causes the volume of the thoracic cavity to suddenly decrease. So what will happen is that the air pressure inside the thoracic cavity, it enhances or it increases. And because the air pressure inside the thoracic cavity becomes high, in order to balance or neutralize the air pressure, certain amount of air or the gases are thrown out of the nasal cavity, and that is known as expulsion or expiration. So what is the mechanism of expiration or exhalation? The process of exhaling carbon dioxide is called expiration, and it's a passive process. Now, when does expiration or exhalation takes place? It occurs when the size of the thoracic cavity decreases and the diaphragm also relaxes. Now, when both the thoracic cavity contracts or decreases in size and the diaphragm relaxes, the entire volume of the thoracic cavity decreases. On decreasing the total volume of the thoracic cavity, the air pressure outside increases and inside the thoracic cavity decreases. Now, the external intercostal muscles, they relax, and the internal intercostal muscles, they contract. As a result, the ribs are pulled inward and the size of the thoracic cavity is reduced. The diaphragm gets relaxed and the lungs are further compressed. Obviously, because of the sudden decrease in the size of the thoracic cavity, the air pressure inside increases, and it causes certain amount of gases to move out of the body through the nasal cavity, which causes expiration or exhalation. So this is a very physical mechanism, how inspiration or inhalation takes place and how expiration or exhalation takes place. And if we follow both these processes, then we will see it is related directly to the volume of the thoracic cavity and equalizing the pressure inside and outside the human body. When thoracic cavity increases in volume, the pressure inside decreases. In order to balance or neutralize the pressure, certain amount of gases or oxygen is inhaled. And when the thoracic cavity suddenly decreases in size, the diaphragm relaxes, the volume of the thoracic cavity suddenly decreases, the air pressure builds up inside. In order to balance or equalize the pressure, gases are given out, and that is when expiration or exhalation takes place. Now, the next thing, once we have understood that what is the structure of the lungs that what is trachea, what is a bronchi, what are bronchioles, what is an alveoli or air sac, and how is it important in the respiration process, what is the difference between breathing and respiration, and what are the two mechanisms of breathing that we have, inspiration or inhalation and expiration or exhalation. And we have talked about the mechanism of these two. And once we have done or talked about the breathing mechanism, inspiration and expiration, we are going to talk about the regulation of respiration. That is also very important. Now, respiration is controlled by the nervous regulation and chemical regulation. So there are two ways of regulating respiration. So first we have is the nervous regulation, and secondly we go on to the chemical regulation. Now, what is nervous regulation of respiration? Three groups of neurons called dorsal group of neurons, ventral group, and pneumotaxic group, they regulate respiration. So you have dorsal, ventral, and pneumotaxic neurons which help in regulating the process of respiration. What is the function of the dorsal neuron? They are located in the dorsal portion of the medulla. Obviously, whenever neurons come, it is your central nervous system, the brain, the spine, and the nerves. Okay. So, the dorsal group of neurons, it is located in the dorsal part of the medulla, that is a part of the brain, and regulate inspiration phase of respiration. The neurons terminated at the NTS as well as in reticular substance. So what is the role of dorsal group of neurons? They help in regulating the inspiration phase of respiration. Now, ventral neurons, they are again in the ventral part of the medulla, and they regulate the inspiration as well as the expiration phase of respiration. And pneumotoxic neuron, they are located in the upper portion of pons terminate at nucleus parabrachialis. Pneumotaxic center, it inhibits the dorsal group of neurons. It means it limits the inspiration. It also increases the rate of breathing. So how do nerves regulate the process of respiration? We see that there are three sets of nerves which are used for the nervous regulation of respiration. We have the dorsal neuron, ventral neuron, and the pneumotaxic neuron. Now, what is the role of dorsal neuron? Now, dorsal neuron, it regulates the inspiration phase, that is the inhalation phase of respiration. Then you have the ventral neuron. It controls both inspiration as well as expiration during the process of respiration. And lastly, we have pneumotaxic center. And pneumotaxic center, it plays an important role in increasing or decreasing the rate of the breathing, coordinates the speed of inhalation and exhalation. So how fast the gases can be inhaled and exhaled is controlled by the pneumotaxic center. So we see that how these three sets of nerves or neurons can manage or regulate the process of respiration. We have dorsal neuron, ventral neuron, and pneumotaxic neuron, and each of them have separate functions to perform. The other method of regulation of respiration is the chemical regulation. So we see that how by the use of nerves or neurons, we can regulate process of respiration. And now the next thing we have is the chemical regulation. So what we can do in chemical regulation of respiration, a carbon dioxide, it directly stimulates chemosensory area present in the medulla. Now, indirectly stimulate the chemoreceptor located on the arc of iota and carotid arc. No need of going into so much details of the structure. Then proton indirectly stimulate the chemosensory area present in the medulla. H plus cannot enter into the blood-brain barrier directly. So carbon dioxide, it passes into the brain and form carbonic acid by reacting with water and break in medulla, and H plus stimulate medulla. Okay. So that is very important. So it's very important to know that how different chemicals or chemical regulation, it helps in the process of respiration. So we see that the carbon dioxide, it stimulates the chemosensory area present in the medulla. Then proton directly stimulate the chemosensory area which is present in the medulla. Proton cannot enter the blood-brain barrier directly. So carbon dioxide pass in brain and from carbonic acid by reacting with water and break in medulla and H plus stimulated medulla. So we see that there are two ways by which the process of respiration can be regulated. The first is by the neuron regulation, making use of the dorsal, ventral and pneumotoxic nerves in order to regulate inspiration, exhalation and the speed of inhalation and exhalation. And the second way by which we can regulate the respiration process is by chemical regulation. So here are a few important questions related to the text, like discuss the difference between breathing and respiration. Then the structure of the lungs. When we talk about lungs, we have to start from the pleural membrane to the pleural fluid to the air sacs. To the thoracic cavity or thorax, to the windpipe or the trachea, then it divides into bronchus. Bronchus gets minimized into bronchioles, resulting in the formation of small air sacs in the end, which are known as the alveoli. Okay, then we talk about the breathing mechanism, about how inspiration or inhalation takes place, how expiration or exhalation takes place, what are the mechanisms of inspiration and expiration. And lastly, we talk about how respiration can be regulated using neurons and chemicals. Okay, then what is the mechanism of inspiration? What is the mechanism of expiration? So I'm sure that after listening to the lecture and solving these set of problems, this topic will be clear to everyone. So this is where I've taken my reference for the physiology of respiration, and I hope it is clear to everyone. And that is all from my side. Thank you very much.